Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here. I've looked forward to it for the last couple of years. Due to what a French author once called the treason of the intellectual, most Americans are uninformed regarding the reality of our national situation. This is not due to any lack of intelligence on the part of the people. It is due almost entirely to the lack of honest information. When all the facts are not revealed, it is impossible to come to accurate conclusions. We are, in other words, inundated by propaganda, by a press that has allied with a massive movement that has long since conquered our schools and our bureaucracy. The people sense this. They know that they are constantly being propagandized, but they're frustrated because the propaganda is too slick to penetrate. The media operates on the principle that whatever it chooses to print can be verified, but what it does not choose to print cannot be easily discovered. And the result is that the people are constantly misled regarding the specifics of our national situation. And therefore, we are controlled to a far greater extent than is admitted. We are not free. Our exercise of free speech is drastically limited, more limited today than at any time in our history. We have more taboos, more subjects and groups that are sacrosanct from criticism than our forebears would have believed possible. We have less rights of property than ever before, because even after we pay off our mortgages, we must pay taxes in order to stay in the house that we bought and paid for, or else the house is confiscated. In that respect, we are in the same position as peasants of a bygone Europe living under feudal overlords. We are taxed without real representation, an issue that led to our original war of independence, because not only Congress, but governmental agencies have the power to tax us in the name of regulation. These agencies, which comprise the fourth branch of government, not created by our Constitution but by Congress, with the connivance of our politicized federal judiciary. Four centuries ago, John Locke wrote about what he called the delegation of power. His immediate example was Charles I, King of England, who sent his agents around the realm collecting money from the rich without the consent of the people. Locke argued that this was unlawful because no official in any public office had the right to delegate the powers of that office to somebody else. After all, he said, one king at a time was all they could afford. Our Congress is the only body constitutionally authorized to enact laws for the nation. When it created agencies and authorized these agencies to write regulations that had the force of law, it gave to Congress, that it gave to unelected individuals outside Congress, authority that only Congress is constitutionally able to exercise. In time, Congress not only delegated the right to issue regulations, but it also told the agencies that they can create their own inspectors to see that the regulations are obeyed, and if the inspectors report disobedience of the regulation, then the agency has its own court in which it can try people for violating regulations, and it can fine them, and it can send them to jail. So therefore, the agencies have put together the three powers that the Constitution originally separated: the right to enact law, the right to administer law, and the right to adjudicate law. On an overall level of government, therefore, Congress created a fourth unelected branch of government that reports only to Congress. And in that manner, Congress rules the nation at one remove from cradle to the grave, much as Charles I extended his tyranny over all the realms of England. This end run around the Constitution was soon imitated by the various state governments, who began to create agencies of their own. And the agencies of the state governments also administer and also adjudicate their regulations. And then the president, not to be outdone, began to issue executive orders. Now, nothing in the Constitution says the President of the United States can issue an executive order to the people of this country. It's not there. So we have now an example of Congress setting up a fourth level of federal agencies, and the states were enabled to double, to triple, to quintuple, to sextuple the number of governmental bodies that they too could create. Then the counties in every state began to issue boards of regulation, licenses for occupations, commissions, and supervisors, and so forth, all with the power to tax and regulate, license, fine, or jail. We have more governments than anybody can count. Nobody has put together the scholarly resources of our very self-satisfied universities to make a list, just a list, of all the governments that we have over us, around us, and under us in the United States. Nobody has ever even counted the number of laws and regulations by which we are governed, leading all the way up to the latest Clean Air Act, which gives the government rights over everything that exists in the air, in the ground, in the water, whether it's animal, vegetable, or mineral, in order to recreate the Garden of Eden, in which everything is perfect. One is reminded of the Ancien Regime in France before the Revolution. France was governed to an extent, said one historian, that is hardly comprehensible to anyone not accustomed to a centralized government. Now, of course, we are accustomed to such government, so we believe. Hardly a bridge was built or a steeple repaired, he said, in Burgundy or Provence without a permission signed by the king. The king in council, and countersigned by the Secretary of State. The Council of Dispatches exercised disciplinary power over authors, printers, and booksellers. It governed schools and revised their rules and regulations. It laid out roads, dredged rivers, and built canals. It took general charge of towns and municipal organizations. Now, many people ascribe this continuing expansion of authority over every aspect of our lives to simple ambition on the part of our political class, which now comprises many millions of individuals whose livelihood comes directly from political activity or from jobs inside the government. This class includes school teachers who work in the nation's largest and most corrupt industry. We'll have to exempt the military because at least their lives are put on the line to protect us from insurrection or attack. But what we can define as the political class is led by professional politicians on federal, state, and local levels who number in the millions, and an even larger number of millions who live occupationally and from need from the federal and state and local treasury. They comprise a vast American minority consisting of all races, both sexes, and all ethnic backgrounds who have a direct stake in an all-powerful government. Most members of this political class don't think in overall terms. They have no sense whatever as to where their escalating share of our taxes is carrying the nation. They are only concerned with their own careers or their own needs and only with their day-to-day problems. Their political leaders, meanwhile, are intent only upon increasing their supporters in every possible way. Governor Clinton calls this investing in America. He wants to recreate Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal. He wants to launch huge public works programs. He wants to rebuild the physical infrastructure of the land, roads, bridges, dams, and post offices. Now, we need not wonder who is going to staff these projects, nor who will be given the managerial posts once they're launched, because the Democrat convention has told us the official minorities will be put in charge: women, blacks, Hispanics, Native Americans, and Asians. Beyond that, the politicians in both major parties, who are both indirectly telling us that this nation cannot function if the people are free. Both their platforms add up to the proposition that we need more governmental agencies, that we need to increase the political class, that we need the government to provide jobs of last resort on governmental terms. And of course, that is the central argument of socialism. First, attack the private sector and the rich. Then legislate it to death. Then say that since it has failed, the government has to step in. And after the government steps in, the government can tell us all what job we will have, and we will have to take it. What the Democrats tell us directly, the Republicans tell us indirectly. President Bush, accused by the Democrat socialists of not taking sufficient governmental action, defends himself by pointing to the Clean Air Act and to the new quota bill, and also to the Employment Disability Act, in which persons with AIDS or suffering from alcoholism or drug addiction or some other calamity will have their equal share at the job you may need. Now, if all this were simply political, we could deal with it fairly directly. Unfortunately, the avenues of public expression, the media, music, the theater, the schools, are controlled by American socialists. And these do not consist of any single particular group. They're spread all across the nation. The shorthand description is intellectual, although the term is far too flattering. Perhaps we should simply call them the politically correct crowd. They constitute an immense body that masqueraded among us in the past as progressives and then as liberals in the recent past, and now have the nerve to call themselves moderates. These are the people who are deliberately changing our language, and it's the new language that's giving us so much trouble. Patrick Cannon is absolutely right. We are in a cultural war, and we have to respond in a cultural as well as in a political term. And this is not going to be easy, because even our dictionaries have become loaded with propagandistic definitions. Words have been unilaterally forced into new uses, and older words have been completely dropped. We are in a situation analogous to those of the ancient Athenians and the Spartans, who discovered at the end of the 30 years of the Peloponnesian War that they could no longer understand the Greek language that they were separately using. Here in the United States, both cultural and political terms have been distorted and misused by our secret socialists in order to misrepresent their critics and to mislead the nation. In the 19th century, for instance, the term liberal meant somebody who believed in a limited government. The politically correct crowd, however, believes in an expanded government, and they call themselves liberals. And of course, they do not openly admit that they believe in expanding the government. They simply say that they believe in helping the people and doing good. Their approach to that goal was succinctly summarized by King James of England 400 years ago, when he was accused of enacting laws that the people, decreeing laws that the people didn't want. He said, "I govern not according to the common will, but the common weal." We are up against people who believe that they are smarter than all the rest of the nation put together. They want to govern over us instead of with us. They don't believe in the original American dream, which was not that every family would own its own house, but that we had here a government that could be limited by the rights of the people. That was the original American dream. The original American dream is no longer even remembered. The real estate lobby tells us it means a house. Now, if a concept as noble as the original American dream can be diminished, imagine how much of our heritage has been brought not only down to earth, but into the mud. It's been brought into the mud by people who are using our language to change our culture, to misrepresent the natural relationships between men and women, to elevate perversity into an alternate lifestyle, to stretch the term family to suit Woody Allen, to call agitators activists and socialists moderates. The list goes on and on. It's our task to punctuate these cultural frauds by describing people, behavior, and events in their proper terms. To label intolerance and bigotry for what it is when it spews its hatred against Christianity and white males and the civilization we inherited from Europe. That's not a simple task because there's an awful lot to unravel. For instance, the two major parties let loose an awful lot of balloons in New York and in Dallas, but they failed to mention the most elemental issues, the use of force, for instance, in the United States, and why the government allows it to continue. Some believe that this is just an accident, but we know better, because we have seen socialists in other countries encourage the use of force in the same way for political ends. They didn't invent the formula. It was tried out here and led to our greatest tragedy, the Civil War. Northern politicians remained silent when the abolitionists used first violent language and then violent resistance over the slavery issue. They knew that silence and a lack of a crackdown meant approval, and that it would lead to further violence, as it did. John Brown eventually lit the match by murdering innocent people to make a political point in 1859. And the war between the states then became inevitable, not because of those murders, but because of their intellectual approval by the North. The outcome of that war changed our government from a confederation to a central state and gave us this federalized power which now presses upon us all. And a watching world was taught, in other words, that the American way of solving a societal problem is through violence in the name of a good cause. We were told that the Civil War was a great triumph. We weren't told that every other nation ended slavery by a stroke of the pen without losing a single life, because our history is too narrowly taught. Now, it may sound as though this is an excursion into the distant past and is a digression, but it isn't. Vigilance, violence is a subject that is tied directly to governmental power. Every one of us can agree with Noah Webster's definition that one of our inalienable rights is the right to be physically safe, and it is the duty of the government to guarantee that safety. And the reason I bring up the Civil War is because it was allowed to occur in order to expand the power of Northern politicians. And the reason that I bring violence up today is because it is being encouraged by socialists who call themselves moderates and liberals, who hope to channel violence to achieve ultimate power here. Violence is the ladder that socialists use to reach power. It is now nearly forgotten, for instance, that when the socialists first became influential on the top levels of this culture in the 1880s and 90s, we had the Haymarket riots, we had pitched battles between labor and capital, we had bombings. In the decades before World War I, we had the IWW, who believed in setting fire to wheat fields and burning down factories in order, they said, to achieve the rights of the working men. We had the same troubles as Europe, because we are not an island alone in the world. President Garfield was assassinated here at the same time that assassinations became common in Europe. And we had the same socialists that Europe had. Only ours called themselves progressives. Later, President Wilson talked about a war to end wars. And you can't believe in violent means for a good end more clearly than that. During that war, all constitutional liberties were suspended. Women and men were sent to the penitentiary for criticizing the conduct and goals of the war. American industry was placed under governmental control for the first time in our history. And the socialists here then realized that this country could be ruled by decree. And they've never forgotten that, and neither should we. Historians now believe that that particular war damaged our civilization as definitely as the Peloponnesian War damaged the civilization of ancient Greece. And the socialists of Europe, in particular, and some here too, made great gains at the end of that war. And it wasn't generally realized that these gains were part of a worldwide socialist movement, because the leaders in the various countries used different names and different terms. We have to accept the idea that the socialist intellectuals used different words to describe the same situations. For instance, the editor of a socialist newspaper in Italy, Benito Mussolini, called himself a fascist, after the old Italian word for fasces, which meant a bundle of sticks bound together, a very old symbol of Roman authority. Under that system, you had the inequality of income of capitalism, and you had titular ownership, but the government took over all authority. And it's ironic to reflect that when the socialists here decide to denigrate conservatives, they call us fascists. And that's very ironic, because fascism came out of socialism. It's a socialist variation. Another socialist member of the Internationale was Lenin. He took 50 million gold marks from Germany during a time when his nation was at war with Germany. He used it to buy 46 newspapers first, because the word comes before the deed, and then guns and food for the recruits for his party. He called his party first socialists as part of the International, then Bolsheviks, then finally communists. But it was based, of course, on the socialist idea of governmental control of all private property. And then they launched a series of plans, five-year plans, not as good perhaps as Mr. Clinton's four-year plan, but nevertheless, they had a plan. And finally, we saw the rise of a socialist government in World War I Germany called the Weimar Republic. And they came to power because President Wilson's socialists thought that Germany shouldn't have a monarchy anymore, it should be more democratic. The country was scarred by war and by inflation. The German Socialist Party was in charge of the government and much of the culture. And they launched a series of campaigns against the traditional German culture. They were in favor of unlimited abortion. They stripped the gingerbread from the German architecture and gave us these stark buildings, the Bauhaus buildings that we're inflicted with. They promoted formlessness in the dance and in music, licentiousness in the theater, and a remarkable efflorescence of homosexuality and lesbianism, and very loud anti-Christianism. They didn't reach the depths of the USSR, which closed down the churches and made atheist museums out of cathedrals. But the German socialists denigrated Christianity and pushed it in a way into an unfashionable second-class intellectual status. And this can be very damaging. And all this spawned an increasingly coarse political dialogue. It grew to the level of obscenities first, countercharges and charges, and then finally ruffians to break up one another's political meetings. Now, we hear a lot about Hitler's stormtroopers, but they were not alone. The other party, the Communist Party in Germany, also had private army. And to forget that is to misdirect the students of that period, because if the Communists had won in Germany, it is very likely Germany would have won World War II. Because the socialists in Britain, France, and the United States would not have wanted to contend against them. Now, none of this is being recited simply to say that socialism injured Russia and Germany. It is cited because in each of these countries, both of these countries, they use minorities to achieve power. In Germany, they used one minority as a target for the majority. But in Russia, they used all the minorities as a target against the Russian majority. The Germans were told that they lost the war because of a stab in the back at home, and that their sufferings under inflation were the fault of a minority. In Russia, the Poles were promised their freedom from the Tsars. The Georgians were told they could regain independence. The Armenians, that they would be protected from the Turks. And the Jews, that all discrimination would be ended. And therefore, we should pay attention when our socialists begin to make promises to our two largest minorities, the blacks and the Hispanics. Together, these minorities add up to roughly 26% of our official population, and in reality, perhaps a bit more. This means, at the very least, over 60 million people. They are daily fed a diet of grievances against the American majority. Some Hispanic leaders talk openly about the time when they will be a majority in the Southwest, and when California, Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas will be returned to Mexico. The blacks in the inner cities are told that their income inequality is not due to any lack of skill, but to injustice, which must be instantly redressed. Instantly. Not by time, not by work, not by their own efforts, but by the policies of change instituted by the government. No other possibilities are mentioned. Now, our government is, of course, aware of this. Congress recently came within a hair of passing a new anti-crime bill, but it was an interesting bill. It had 13 new death penalties in it, all to protect officials of the government. Meanwhile, we have 23,000 murders a year. Metropolitan robberies and burglaries are so numerous that the police are overwhelmed. And these are not only signs of trouble at hand, but of worse troubles to come. When the highest officials are silent regarding an event as terrible as the LA riots, I am reminded of the silence of the northern officials when the abolitionists got out of hand. And as an expert in pre-revolutionary period, I can assure you that our situation in many respects parallels precisely the pre-revolutionary situation in Germany and Russia, Italy, and even before that in France. The assault on traditional art, which has reached the level of governmental sponsorship of anti-Christian filth, the assault on harmony and melody and traditional music, the rise of rock bands, their heavy metal and the drum beat, which unloose the passions of the young, the cinema dumping on all our values, ensure us that we know the cultural war is real. We know the minorities are not being organized against the majority for no purpose. We know that intolerance is preached in the name of tolerance, hatred in the name of anti-hatred, racism in the name of anti-racism, censorship in the name of free speech. Orwell would recognize this. New speak is driving out old speak, new language for old, new goals are being mounted in the name of change. Some politicians know this, and certainly our socialists, who use an entire lexicon of deceptive descriptions for themselves, know it. What the people do not know is that socialism did not die with Hitler and Mussolini or Gorbachev or Yeltsin. It's a full-fledged ideology that permeates the governing classes of the United States, Britain, France, contemporary Italy, and most of the rest of the world. It's here. It's among us. It rules us. The name changes, but the process remains the same. And it's our task to convince people that there is no such thing as voluntary socialism. In its complete form, it must force. It doesn't promise to make anyone rich. It promises only that nobody will get rich. It offers the equality of poverty. Now, it's our belief that the socialists of this land, entrenched though they seem to be in the media and in academe and in government, is not dislodgeable. We can overcome. History records that those who are capable of perceiving the real causes of a crisis are capable of resolving it. And the fact that we are in crisis is indisputable. The primary of both parties, especially during the primary of both major parties, proved that a third of all their registered voters had turned against them. Pat Buchanan received a good third of the Republican Party, Jerry Brown a third of the Democrat Party. And when Ross Perot, the fake candidate, appeared, voters in both parties turned to him, though he was a mystery with no platform at all. Now, no greater proof of political disillusion could have possibly appeared. In New York's Democratic primary, with all the headlines that it created, only 5% appeared to vote. 95% of the registered Democrats didn't even bother to vote in New York primary. Now, we can't blame them, because actually all the candidates run on one program. And finally, elections no longer settle the issue. Campaigns extend around the clock all year, every year. But just over the horizon, there are signs that the people have had enough. We're a very patient and tolerant country, but we cannot be fooled forever. The socialist effort to suppress the majority in the name of the minorities will not succeed, because the real American majority does not consist of a single race or a single ethnic group, but of everyone who shares in the traditional beliefs of this country. It's that the majority that we are gathered here today to rally. We believe in a party that does not seek to use minorities as instruments against the majority, but a party that represents all who are hardworking, patriotic, and loyal to the United States of America. These are the real Americans, and we welcome them all, irrespective of creed, color, and national origin. We welcome them, and we urge them to join a party led by a man whose courage is high enough to stand tall against a naked elite, which claims to be moderate when it is actually radically socialist. A man experienced in the intricacies of government, who has been tested by authority, who has organized this alternative party by his own efforts from the ground up, who is willing to bear the enormous burdens it involves, who is willing to endure the silence of the media, the indifference of the threatened, and the fears of the timid. And that man, as I'm sure you know, is Howard Phillips, Chairman. Chairman of the Conservative Caucus, fighter against international socialism in the 70s and 80s, political leader par excellence, Howard Phillips is the man to whom this nation will turn in the most perilous period of its history. A man destiny will discover waiting and ready when the big crunch comes. When the meaning of authoritarian socialism will appear before all the people naked in its reach for power. And it is then, later in this decade, that Howard Phillips will be fine, prepared, and ready to take the helm of this newly born U.S. taxpayers' party and to move the party from this modest birthplace to a far larger and more important place on the political and cultural landscape of the United States. Thank you very much.